Sometimes I'm there in the background for ages and you're eating and you chew loud, man. You need to like close your mouth.
All right,
you,
Waterborne.
Hey, let's not start with that when you're in the bad books today, referring to...
I had a nightmare, didn't I? I called him a lady friend on the inaugural Shepherd Paddock Q&A live Houses Brew today. Yeah, it didn't go down well. I didn't mean it as an insult. I meant it like, obviously, you know, she's not an associate. She is
a lady and she is a friend.
Yeah, and you know, she's also the mother of my children and the woman I live with and I'm going to spend the rest of my life with. But the way it came out, it sounded like it doesn't matter.
I think if you say mother of my children, that sounds worse.
It's very Tony Soprano's, isn't it?
Yeah.
You know, when he says it, Carmela kicks off, doesn't she? She says, that's what, when you say, he says, I love you, you're the mother of my children. You make it sound like I'm just someone to procreate with. So, yeah, I need to stop that one, actually. All right, my girlfriend doesn't quite do it justice.
No. I just go for default, my missus.
Yeah, my missus. To be honest with you, if I'm online, if I'm doing it on Twitter or whatever, I usually say missus, so I'll stick to that, yeah. Good shout. I'm glad we got that out of the way. What are we talking about tonight?
We're talking about comedians, top five comedians, which again will be a difficult task. I was trying to, I did my top five when we talked about it last night and it's been chopping and changing. So I'm just going to go and freestyle it. I'm just going to see where we go. Mate, you know,
that's,
just fucking,
that's fair enough. I mean,
improv.
I gave you my five last night and during the course of the day, I've been back and forth and back and forth. And I just thought, you know what? No. I'm sticking to that five, right? Because I have a reason for every one of those five that I've chosen.
Yeah.
So I can give you a reason why they've made my top five. Now, you can ask me tomorrow when I might have a different top five and a different reason, but I've got these reasons for it. So I'm going to stick with it because there's, you know, it'll make sense. And there's no drama here. I'm not going to be like, oh, why didn't I do that or whatever? Because the comedians I've chosen are all outstanding in their own right.
Yeah, I completely agree. Before we start, thanks everyone who's been following. We've gone up 700 plus now. Comments have been great and everyone has been getting involved. Obviously, I'm Scotty, he's Motty. We're going to talk about our top five. The other way, how many, you do about 5 million podcasts that you are missed the podcast.
I know, mate. I'm so sorry. I'm just, like, someone said that to me. Someone said, how have you only got 700 subscribers when you're on YouTube constantly?
I think that it's because you've diluted your product or it's your co-host on this show. I don't know which one.
You've elevated us to 700. But to be fair, I know from, and I don't want to bore people with baffling with science, but I know that the people that are subscribing and watching are engaged. They tend to leave comments. They tend to watch quite a long portion of the videos, which with me and you isn't easy because we go on for hours and we appreciate that. So, you know, it's more like I've said many times, and as you said earlier, we give you all a big thank you and, you know, tell your friends, spread the love. Go on then, my friend. I'll let you go first. Who's going to be your first pick for the top five?
My first pick will be, I'm choosing this comedian because I think it's the first sort of comedian that I came to without my mum and dad trying to fucking ram Fawlty Towers or David Jason down your throat when you're growing up. And it was the sort of first one that I thought, right, I like that. You know, when you're rebelling against your parents and stuff and he's talking about risque subjects, it's like, if your mum clocks you listening to this shit, you're gonna be for a good hiding. And it's Bill Hicks. And Bill Hicks for me is more than a... He's always been more than a comedian. He's more sort of like a prophet, a shaman. I read a book on him a few years ago, and they referred to him as Noam Chomsky with dick jokes. And I think that pretty much just sort of sums him up because he's very, very political, but yet he can also do the sort of toilet humor that is always, you know, fart and dick jokes never go out of date. No, they always age well as long as people have farting of penises, you know, we're good for longevity with them jokes, but it's just incredible. And I think the way I came to Bill Hicks was through our old mate Donny Dyer. Do you remember Human Traffic?
Yes, I do. It's Danny Dyer's only very good film.
Ooh. I don't think we need any controversial remarks on, but all of them West Ham fans coming in saying, like, you're incorrect, Mall Rats or City Rats, whatever, it was a classic. But he's in Human Traffic, and I think is it John Sim that plays the lead character in Human Traffic? And so his character, I'm going to grasp at Jip, I think he's called. He always plays a Bill Hicks video before he goes out. And it's this monologue that Bill Hicks used to sign off his shows. And it's about how life's a ride, stop taking it all so serious. You know, we'll have ups and downs. And what happens is people take life too seriously and try to fuck up your ride and stuff. And then people are demons that run amok. And then he goes on about George Bush and so on and so forth. But it's all like, Bill Hicks for me always seems to have like quite a Buddhist, I mean, this doesn't sound very funny in the slightest, but he always had sort of like a Zen sort of profile about him. He didn't really take much stuff very seriously. And I think that's what allowed him to poke fun at so many different religions and politics and stuff like that. One of my favorite, and Christians and Catholicism in particular, he was all, because he came from Texas, which, you know, is part of the Bible Belt in America. And one of my favorite Bill Hicks jokes is when he talks about, he's done a show slagging off Jesus or God, and then some hillbillies at the back of a diner in Texas have come up to him and said, hey buddy, I didn't like what you were saying about Jesus. And he goes, well, forgive me then. And it's just fucking, he's just so brilliant.
What I love about that, I love that. I also love the fact that your Texans sound like they're from Newcastle.
I think apparently all my accents sound like, you know, there was a time when I was going to go into impersonations, and if it's Alan Shearer, I'm laughing.
Alan Shearer, Alan Deck, get Scotty on, mate. You tell you what, you can't get wrong.
I honestly, my Jamaican sound good. What are you saying about Jesus?
That's quality. That's the best Texan accent I've ever heard in my life. That is uncanny. I think you're from like the Dallas region, from that dialect.
Yeah, and yet again, this sort of like is the reason I don't go down well in Sunderland. I just love Bill Hicks and his comedy, despite him I think he died at the age of 32, and despite him dying that young, and I think it was like, it always makes me wonder when you have these sort of cult heroes and then when you surpass them in age, it's like we're both the same age. You're older than Martin Luther King, but older than Bill Hicks, Bob Marley, you know, Tupac. And it just, you know, it always makes me massively appreciate how much they'd done in the short time that they were here. But yeah, it's such a fantastic talent. Yeah, the point I was trying to make is that he refers to stuff like George Bush, the Iraq War, shit music, and it's still relevant today. You can just take out the name of the president and you could put Donald Trump in there, and it's exactly the jokes, just, you know, they really stand the test of time. Well, Bill Hicks is absolutely fantastic. If you're going to watch one clip on YouTube, just watch Bill Hicks on It's Just a Ride monologue. It's not particularly funny, but it's just, it sort of sums him up and his whole ethos on life. And I read his biography and he actually signed it off. The last words he actually written was, I left in love, in laughter, and in truth. And wherever truth, love, and laughter abide, I am there in spirit. And I think that just pretty much sums him up. Like I said, he was more than a comedian. He was like a philosopher, prophet. And he talks about LSD and stuff. And during that time was my Jackie Chan phase. So there we go.
No, I'm with you. Love Bill Hicks. You know, as soon as I saw you chosen him when we were chatting last night, I thought that's a great shout, because he's one of the greatest. He is. And, you know, the fact that he died when he was 32 is a shame, because, you know, going into his middle age, he would have had different sort of takes on things and, you know, different life experiences share. And it would, you know, it's deprived us of even more laughs. But, you know, you just got to be grateful that we had him as long as we did. And like you say, his ability to mix the sort of the toilet humour and the just light-hearted stuff and the parody stuff with the more serious sort of commentary is fantastic. I mean, the way he delivers his jokes as well. I remember seeing Bill Hicks telling people in advertising to go and kill themselves. And he was like, you know, if you work in advertising, go and kill yourself. This isn't a joke. No, please, go and kill yourself. And then he was like, you know, there's people in the audience who work in advertising talking to each other now going, you know, that's really clever what he's doing. That's really good. That's really good. From a marketing point of view, that's so clever. And he's like, I'm not being clever. Kill yourself. And it's like, that's quite brutal. But it's funny. Do you know what I mean? It is. It's just like he could be quite dark, but just hilarious with it. And like he said, he had a message, he had something to say. He wasn't just telling jokes that were, you know, almost meaningless. There was an edge to it. And like you say, you know, but George Bush Sr., I think it was, wasn't it? Was highly critical of, because George Bush Sr. had more or less funded Iraq during the Iraq-Iran war and then turned on him. And he was one of the few people that was speaking out against that, because, you know, that Iraq war was immensely, for want of a better expression, popular in America, because they felt they were liberating Kuwait. Bush's approval rating was in the 90s. Everyone thought it was a great idea and loved it. It wasn't like the second Iraq war when people questioned it. And he was speaking out against it when others weren't. And I think that's a sign of a really good sort of comedian who can take it to that next level as well and get people thinking about certain issues. And yeah, I'm glad we picked him, mate, because it would have been remiss if we didn't have him on, because he's a comedian's comedian, isn't he? Loads of comedians, when you ask him.
Yeah.
The old site bill, a lot of them on site bill.
Oh yeah, I know. Frankie Boyle. I'm not too sure makes either of our list, but anyway. But Frankie Boyle sites.
He's got me on Twitter, so he's not going to make my fucking list.
Oh right, okay. Fucking hell, Jesus. we'll have that next top five. Do who we block by?
that'll be a long one. That we do top 500. You
know, Ollie Hall happy hour. Anyway, fucking. But yeah, so I mean, he did that much to his detriment, because I think that when he was critical of religion and the US government, he wasn't very big in America until after he passed away. I think he actually became, you know, sadly it happens too often, and we were talking about one of your favourite artists, Jimi Hendrix, is that England really embraced him. I think he did the Edinburgh Festival, and then that really propelled him. And I think he was on The Word as well, like that, and he became like a cult figure in England. And then when he passed away, I think he did Letterman, and Letterman pulled one of his shows and stuff. So, yeah.
He played it after he died.
The fucking pussy.
Yeah, but no, you know, you're right.
So yeah, it became bigger that once it passed away. But I think England, it's always funny with humour and stuff, because Americans say we've got a better sense of humour than them. Would you agree with that? And I think majority of Americans that we've chosen our list tonight. But anyway, I digress. Over to you, Motty. Who have you got on your first one?
For sort of one exchange, for this one, I'll pick this one because when I was a kid, me and you have spoken about this on previous podcasts. One of my favourite stand-up routines or videos that my mate had was Delirious by Eddie Murphy. Now, I wasn't going to put Eddie Murphy in because I think he's a better sort of comedy actor than he's a comedian. And his stand-up, you know, there's probably better stand-ups than Eddie Murphy. There's probably a lot more than four or five better stand-ups, so he probably wouldn't make most people's top five. But I just think from a personal point of view, he was the first one who got me into stand-up. So I thought I'd choose him for that. Like I said, you know, there's a reason for each one of my choices. And he made me go and look at other stand-ups that I'll get to later as well. You know, sometimes I've done it in like the reverse order. I've seen someone and then looked at, they've influenced me into look at earlier work from another comedian or an earlier work from another filmmaker or whatever. And that was very much the case of Eddie Murphy. And I just like the way he was able to, I mean, it's proper un-PC, and you have to get past that, because you can watch it and you can think, there are homophobic jokes, and he's apologized for this. And there's certain things he says about like the AIDS pandemic, which is just out of order and it's wrong. But there's a lot of, you know, getting past that, there's a lot of funny material in there. And you can see with Eddie Murphy why he went on to have such a successful film career. You know, he does bits like he impersonates his drunken dad at a barbecue. It doesn't matter whether you're from New York or whether you're from Longsight or Earl and whatever, we can all relate to that. It's kicking off, your dad levered, kicking off with the family, telling them all about themselves. Do you know what I mean? One by one. And it's just hilarious. You know, the ice cream one we've spoken about before, just little bits like that, impersonations that he does. He's just quality. And the thing with Eddie Murphy is he was so iconic because on the back of his stand-up, he was on Saturday Night Live, and then he got acting roles and Hollywood roles, and he became the first sort of black superstar Hollywood actor. You know, Beverly Hills Cop made like 250 million or whatever, was the biggest film, I think, of 1984. And this was at a time when, you know, black actors got roles and black comedians got roles, but not a blockbuster like that. This, you know, he broke sort of all sorts of records and made everyone think, well, actually, do you know what? You know, we can cast this guy or other people like him. And he's one of those Eddie Murphy revisionists. Now you can be quite critical of him because when he returned to stand-up, he wasn't quite as good later on in his career. And when he, some of the films he made later on in his career, when he went sort of to the family Disney era, say, making those types of films, they weren't, you know, Dr. Dolittle type films, they weren't always great, but they're for, you know, aimed at a sort of younger audience. But I just think as a stand-up, he was quality, and he paved the way as well. People give Eddie Murphy a little bit of stick. They used to give him stick because he said, I think it was Spike Lee who had a go at him saying, you know, you need to use your platform more for black actors. And if you look at the films he made, he did. He made lots of films where, when he was heavily involved in producing and writing and stuff, like Harlem Nights and Vampire in Brooklyn and films like that, where you'd have a lot of black actors. And he gave people like Chris Rock, Damon Wayans, Dave Chappelle. He gave them breaks in film as well, or he had them in his films at a time when they were sort of fledgling comedians or just breaking out into acting. So he did give people an opportunity. And, you know, my kids love Eddie Murphy because of the Shrek films. That's how they know him. But yeah. I just loved him for those early stand-up, Delirious and Raw, and some of the other stuff he did. He's just a very funny guy, and his stand-up was very good. And it's sort of the different ways he was able to look at, you know, he was able to just mock everything. I think the one thing with Eddie Murphy is where, like, Bill Hicks could be quite serious, and some of the other comedians we'll talk about have that serious side to them in terms of the dealing with certain issues and the trying to get a little bit of a message across.
Yeah.
A lot of the time, Eddie Murphy's just taking the piss.
Yeah.
He's taking a piss out of everything, whether it's a fatal disease, whether it's himself, whether it's other actors. You know, he was taking a piss out of Bill Cosby before it was fashionable. Do you know what I mean? It was, you know, he did that. I mean, when Bill Cosby made the mistake of ringing him and telling him not to be, you know, take the piss as much. So he put it into his act and did a thing about Bill Cosby phoning him and telling him what to do. So, you know, he was just... I just think he was a really good comedian, especially in that sort of golden period of Eddie Murphy in the sort of early 80s, late 70s, early 80s, when he was first starting out and when he first started to get big. Yeah, he was just a funny guy. And for me, as a kid, when I first watched Delirious and then Raw, he had me in stitches. He really did. And it made me think, oh, you know, because he name check all the comedians and I think, oh, I'll go and check them out, some of which I'll get to later. So, yeah, I'll just put him in there for that because, yeah, like I say, there's probably, if you're going to list the sort of top 20 comedians, he might not make it, but for me, he's one of the greats.
Yeah, definitely. I mean, for me, I always looked to Eddie Murphy, and I know he was heavily influenced by Richard Pryor, but he's always he was just a god, wasn't he? He was like the first rock and roll star comedian. Nobody was as well dressed as Eddie Murphy, and I don't think anybody bar him and Prince could pull off that fucking, you know, that sort of outfit. But yeah, it was just. I mean, it's a saying that people use today, living his best life. But that's what he was on stage, on and off the stage. He knew that he was fucking number one in Hollywood, and he lived that life, didn't he? Really, he just fucking pushed it to the maximum. And when you're talking about him, he gave Dave Chappelle a break on The Nutty Professor, wasn't it? I think
like Dave Chappelle had been in. I think he was in Robin Hood Men in Tights as one of his first films, Archie. Which wasn't a very good film, being brutally honest. Mel Brooks' film, but not one of Mel Brooks' better ones. But basically, Eddie Murphy gave Dave Chappelle a platform to be Dave Chappelle in the film almost.
Yeah.
Just like a parody version of himself as a stand-up comedian.
He wearing his hat and that, and he?
Had a big afro. I think he wore fake teeth, but he was like a sort of version of himself, a little bit more brutal version of himself, a little bit less funny version of himself, I'm being honest. But it was a good break for Dave Chappelle and made people go and watch him. You know, I think Chris Rock was he in Vampire in Brooklyn? I can't remember. I think he was in one of them. Damon Wayans.
I think Chris Rock plays the chauffeur, I think.
So, I mean, he gave people a break, but he was a good influence as well. People watched Eddie Murphy, you know, young black comedians said, you know what, he's on Saturday Night Live. He's selling out comedy shows. He's, you know, making blockbuster films. You know, we can give it a go, and he sort of paved the way in a little bit. Probably not as influential as someone like Richard Pryor, but not to be dismissed. And unlike Richard Pryor, he had a hugely successful film career off the back of his comedy as well. So yeah, I just think Eddie Murphy that he's one of those that it's mad because when you watch some of his comedy now, looking back, you think, "Rah," but he's just a funny guy. Do you know what I mean? He's just got that ability, just can make people laugh. And he was on Comedians in Cars Getting Coffee with. Jerry Seinfeld. I watched an episode of that, and Jerry Seinfeld was just like, you know what, because they started at around the same time, he's just like, I love you, and you were, because Eddie Murphy was like 17 when he was doing stand-up. He told a story like, his dad dropped him off at a club, and he said, I did my act, and it bombed, and then the promoter refused to pay me, and it was like 3 o'clock in the morning, and he had to ring my dad, get him to come pick me up. My dad's like, oh, yeah, you're a comedian. Yeah, yeah, yeah. This is very funny. I mean, jokes. Get a real job and all that. Because he said, like, you know, he's a 17-year-old, like, at these clubs and that, just doing his acts. And he that's why I think he was on Saturday Night Live when he was, like, 20. Or, you know, yeah. Made Beverly Hills Cop, I think, when he was, what, 23, 24, or something stupid.
That's so, what I mean. Like, hindsight, when you look back at how young these people were making these moves, it's just incredible. I mean, especially for a young black man in the 80s to be having
that. I mean, he's just a megastar, do you know what I mean?
Yeah.
So, just a great... And I like Eddie Murphy, I do. I think, you know, people can be a bit harsh on him, revisionist or whatever, but I still have a soft spot for him, and I still think he's a funny guy, and he's usually good box office if you watch him in an interview.
Yeah, definitely. Right, I'm going to bring it a bit closer to home. And I was a bit nervous. I am a bit nervous about talking about this one because I just don't think there's any words to describe the influence or how great of a comedian and writer this person is, because he's created the greatest comedy character of all time. We were talking about how Tony Soprano's the greatest TV character? But I'm best comedy character by a country mile is Alan Partridge. Without a fucking shadow of a doubt, there is no way that there is anybody better. You'll get some dickhead down the white lion who thinks it's Del Boy, but you're wrong, mate. You're just wrong. Like, Alan Partridge is absolutely brilliant. And Steve Coogan, of course. So I don't know where to start with him, but I remember the first thing that I remember of Steve Coogan was when we were passing VHS tapes around in school. Yes, I am that old. I know I don't look it. But we were passing VHS tapes. We were either passing Snoop Doggy Dogg's Doggy Style or Three Weddings, Two Fights and a Funeral, which was Paul Kaff's video diary. And it was just hilarious. And we were just doing quotes for that in the playgrounds today, for days. And it was like whoever was a bit overweight was getting called Fat Bob the Fat Blobby Bastard. Or anyone who was wearing anything but kickers would call you Shit Shoe Bastard and a bag of shark. You know what I mean? It was just like, if you haven't seen this, I don't think it's available on any streaming services, but it's so, so funny. He's playing a parody of... the Hugh Grant film Four Weddings and a Funeral, but it's about it's a video diary of Paul Kaff, this Man City fan from North Manchester, and you're talking about being un-PC Eddie Murphy. This might not go down well, but he does this joke and he goes, "Yeah, I'm a feminist. You have to be these days to get your end away." And it's just, but he's just completely like, if anyone knows any Man City fans from like early night Manchester with a fucking bad haircut who drank fucking, we just absolutely nailed him. But that was brilliant, and it was a good cast in that as well. I think John Tomlinson played Fat Bob.
John Thompson, yeah.
And Steve Coogan plays Paul Kaff and his sister Pauline Kaff as well, who marries this Greek drug dealer called Spiros. It's just fucking, it's just farcical. And that was my first introduction to Steve Coogan, and it was only later on, and it was so much later when I got into Alan Partridge that I went backwards and realized that Alan, you know, that it was the actual same person that created Three Weddings, Two Fights and a Funeral. But just talking about his stand-up, his stand-up was great as well. Do you remember the character that he did, Duncan Thicket?
Oh, I do remember Duncan Thicket, yeah.
Yeah, where he plays like this sort of nerdy bloke who always gets picked on. He goes, you ever notice how you leave the house and your coat's all right, but you get home and you've got a load of gauze on the back. What's all that about? And he can't work out that people have been spitting on him in the street. And then, of course, so we've got to talk about Alan Partridge, because, I mean, where do you start with Alan Partridge, Jay? It's just, you know, radio was fantastic. He's doing a podcast now, TV series, the spin-off where he actually got cancelled from TV and goes and lives in a hotel and brings his own plate down for breakfast, or he gets bored, so he's dismantling what are they called, Dolby the trouser presses, and fuck it. And it's just, you know, again, in politically correct, I don't know how well it go down in Ireland now, the way he sort of talks about the Irish. Do you know what I mean? It goes on Sunday, bloody Sunday, where you got to take the kids for a walk and wash your car and all that's a nightmare. Smell my cheese. Let me shock you. I actually like white. You know what I mean? There's just quotes for days, and you can't talk about Coogan without talking about Armando Iannucci as well. Obviously, he was fucking, you know, he was a massive influence and helped shape the character. But, you know, he put Norwich on the map. Nobody had ever heard of Norwich before Alan Partridge. And then even beyond the actual one-liners and storyline. I always think the clothes that he wears or the music that Alan Partridge listens to was always sort of fantastic. There's one where he goes about he's in the studio and he's going about Big Yellow Taxi by Joni Mitchell, where she's going on about putting up a parking lot in Paradise. Well, Joni, you don't realise that would have helped with the pedestrianisation or something. Or the Castrol GTX that's on his back of his coat where he's going to his boss's funeral. He's trying to pitch for another show. And it's just days and days and days. And then his last series on... we're just brought back to BBC last year. And there's one where he goes about hand hygiene, and it's so relevant now after the whole coronavirus, where he does all this sort of dance where you don't have to use your hands to go to the toilet and on a train, and he's sort of using that to open the door, and you use that one to a flush. It's just, and you know, you find yourself doing that now because you don't want to touch anything in inside, but it's just, it never ages. I can Alan Partridge is on, I'm watching it, and I'm still laughing as hilariously as I was the first time I watched it. It's just absolutely timeless. It's very British, but it's probably the greatest thing to come from these shows. And I think global, I just think it's an absolutely fantastic piece of work. And Coogan as a stand-up was great, but I mean, I don't think he'll regret that he will always be synonymous with that character. How could you at all? It's just amazing.
No, I agree. I went to see him down in, I think it was in Oxford, and his stand-up was Steve Coogan does Alan Partridge and some less successful characters, where he did like Saxon Dale and he did Paul and Pauline Calf.
Yeah,
but I'm glad you brought up Paul Calf, because that I was like you. I had that on. I mean, I had it on tape, on VHS, and like it's so fucking funny. It's hilarious. Like when the police raid him and he's arguing with the copper, and he said, you know. He says, can I just apologise for the altercation that took place between myself and yourself outside the Taj Mahal on the high street? But you weren't out of order.
They have a Ford Capri as well.
It's just like, it's so funny. Or the way where he goes, you see where he goes to the cinema and he has that argument with a guy, with that woman.
Yeah.
It's a paradox, you daft cow. It's just like, it's just little things like that. It's so funny. And, you know, like you say, with Partridge, so quotable again, you know, the thing where he's got that stalker who's got a tattoo of him and things
Jed, the mentalist. Get away from me, you mentalist, where he's got the tattoo on his face, on his chest.
And things like that. And then I was worried a little bit when he came back for the BBC thing recently. I thought, oh, this could be a bit, you know, a bit hit and miss or whatever. But it was really, again, it was really funny. He still got it. Like you said, the toilet thing, he's got the IRA guy that looks like him singing Black and Tans, whatever it was, up the IRA. It's like, you start there, up the right, you start there thinking, how's he getting away with this? But it's hilarious. And, you know, and he's obviously Steve Coogan. I saw a thing, I read a book with Frank Skinner, and he said he had a lot of respect for Steve Coogan. Steve Coogan used to go up, and it was all character driven, his comedy. And sometimes, like, you've got a load of drunken comedy fans, they can, because you're not telling jokes necessarily, sometimes they're not into it. And he said he'd go up there and he'd keep trying, he never gave up until he honed these characters in the right way and they, you know, made them more just funnier, really. Where Frank Skinner would go up and he'd be firing off jokes and sort of have the crowd laughing. But yeah, Steve Coogan, I think he sort of, what I like about Steve Coogan, he's done loads of different things, Annie, you know, like Saxon Dale. He's done the one like The Curator and stuff like that, and Gareth Cheeseman and stuff like that. He's had all these characters throughout the years, and he will forever be sort of known, like you said, synonymous with Partridge. But there's others out there, and it's like, if you love Partridge, you should go and check out Steve Coogan's other work. Because like you said, the Paul Calf one was only like two episodes. Have you ever seen, funny enough, just memory, have you ever seen The Dead Good Show? He did. One-off comedy special with Carolina Hearn.
That was
funny. But yeah, he's a great actor. He's sort of weird in it because he's had this Hollywood career as well, hasn't he, Steve Coogan?
Yeah.
He's like Tropic Thunder and what's the one with which is, you know, was nominated for an Academy Award for Best Film, I think.
I think he written that as well, didn't he?
I know he was in it, but yeah, you know, and obviously he's been involved in the Hats Off campaign and stuff like that. But yeah, just a different type of comedian, like you say, more character driven, but just hilarious, man. And you know, people who've seen Patch, you should go and check out his other stuff. I'm glad you brought him up, actually, because you forget about people like Duncan Thicket, but yeah, just funny guys, man. Funny stuff. Brilliant. Brilliant. My next one, sort of moving forward, would be, we'll keep it in the same vein because, you know, you've gone British. So I think probably the comedian that's been the most influential in my life in terms of most quotable and the one that we've all quoted and we all retell his jokes and stories, and he's just an absolute living legend, and it's Peter Kay. Whether, you know, you talk about characters and stuff, whether it's Max and Paddy or Phoenix Knights, he's always hilarious, or Car Share. But as a stand-up, I just think he's one of a kind. He really is. And there's something special about Peter Kay. He's very sort of British. He, Peter Kay is one of the few British comedians who's been massive in Britain, sold out arenas, yet has never tried to go to America or even shown any interest in trying to crack America. You know, others like Lee Evans or Billy Connolly or whoever, you know, will have that sort of thing. But he hasn't. He's very British, but he's just a hilarious guy. You know, and you ever watch, I've seen so many different Peter Kay stand-ups and they've always been so funny. And it's like, you know, he can just talk about anything, and it doesn't matter whether he's talking about growing up and, you know, whether you're living with his sister and his dad and his mum or whatever, his grandma, or whether he's talking about just watching things on the telly, you know, watching My Big Fat Gypsy Wedding or whatever. He just makes everything hilarious. He's just got that about him where he is. He's just a force of nature, Peter Kay. He really is. And everyone, I don't even think it's a northern thing, but I know from our perspective, everyone I know loves him. Everyone I know has either been to see him or loves his comedy. And, you know, there was just a time when it was just garlic bread, was just everyone was saying
you
it.
You couldn't go in a pub. It was like Wonderwall. It's like Wonderwall. You did Wonderwall on a jukebox, or you did garlic bread on the fuck. Everyone was it the Live at the Tower or something?
Yeah,
like that?
A DVD
everyone got for Christmas, wasn't it?
Yeah. When we were in Malia, funnily enough, it was massive. Then everyone, I remember seeing it on T-shirts and everyone saying it. But he's just one of those comedians that just, he can tell he's sort of one of those comedians that loves his craft. I mean, Peter Kay, you know, he does all the arenas, he does all the sellout tours, he does all that, but he does the local clubs, he does that to hone his craft. I've spoken to people who've seen him, he pops up in a comedy pub somewhere just to sort of practice or whatever, and he's just ridiculously talented, ridiculously funny. He's like the benchmark, I think, for British comedians now. I think it's almost like, you know, he's at the very top almost, and it's like, how do you compare to him? Because he's just got that ability to be so relatable. You know, it's no matter what he's talking about, you get it. And a lot, yes, he tells jokes and stuff, but a lot of it's just talking about life, innit? It's just talking about things that you go through when you've got a job. Because, I've read Peter Kay's books and stuff, and he had a job at a petrol station. He had a job at Franny Lee's packing toilet roll. He's not just sort of gone straight from school to comedy. He's had these sort of crappy jobs. And if you watch things like that Peter Kay thing, you know, where he does all these characters, different characters, he's so talented. You know, you saw him when he did Britain's Got the Pop Factor, where he was playing like Geraldine, the Northern Irish transsexual. Or he'll play that Peter Kay thing. He'll play all these different characters. He's a fantastic actor, Peter Kay, as well. He really is. He's a really talented actor. But just as a stand-up comedian, I mean, he's just second to none. I think he really is. I think if Peter Kay is on the telly, especially, you just sit down and watch it, and you're just guaranteed to laugh for the next 90 minutes or whatever. He's just got that about him, man. And the way he talks about things, anyone can relate to it. Do you know what I mean? Even going to the chippy, he makes that funny. Do you know what I mean? It's just little things like that when he tells these stories and you think, oh, yeah, I've done that. Or that happens. Well, my mum's like that, or my gran's like that. And it's just like, you know, I was at my mum's the other day and, we're talking about just recording something. And it's like when he says he went down to his grandma's house and stood in the kitchen being quiet because they were taping something and they didn't want their voices to come out on the tape. Do you know what I mean? Or there's a power cut. I thought there was a power cut, but then the bus went past with its lights on. You know what, you can relate to that. It's the sort of shit my nan used to say. So yeah, he's just a funny guy, and no matter what, if we were going to do list lies, he'd have to be on it for me. If you hadn't chosen him, I'd have to, because I was about 19, 20 when he first came onto the scene, and he's just been consistently brilliant. He has, and you know, whether it's television or his stand-up, he's just one of the top comedians on the planet, and I think we're lucky to have him as well. And it's great that he's from down the road from Bolton, because a lot of his humour his northern humour. He makes jokes about that, about going to the chippy and, you know, the Cockney's not having anything moist. Yeah. You know, you get it, you don't. I think we're quite lucky to have him so sort of close to home, because a lot of what he says we can relate to. And he's got that almost every man feel about it. Some comedians, when they make millions, they struggle to sort of tell these stories because you think, well, you know,
yeah,
you're a millionaire, how? But when he tells it, when he talks about going to the cinema and pick and mix, do you know what I mean? And whoa, fudge, what are you doing? You know, like,
yeah, because of the way of fudge.
Yeah, you don't think, well, what's it matter to you? You're worth millions. You're laughing with him, aren't you? Because he's got that every man appeal, and the way he is, he still seems like this bloke from Bolton. Do you know what I mean?
Yeah,
I just love that.
I think the testament to, well, there's lots of testaments to Peter Kay, but it's how many comedians followed suit and failed miserably trying to do the everyman act. Because if you look at someone like, and I'm not, I don't want to have a pop at Michael McIntyre, but he's shit.
Do you know what I mean?
But he is like a very, very bad posh Peter Kay, because he tries to do the everyman sort of, and he just fails so much. And it's because he's not relatable at all. But that was Peter Kay's natural gift, wasn't it? He was always up there, and he was never shy about his weight or something. Sometimes, you know, it wasn't part of his acts, but he was just very honest and very open. And when I first started doing my gigs and stuff, I was always very nervous about standing on stage and talking. So I went and seen a few acting coaches, or just to try and work on, you know, stage presence, because I'd watched Peter Kay. And when I was, because I'm not going to be shy about it, I was going to learn how what's the best way to sort of walk and move around the stage. And I went and seen a mate, Simon Naylor, who's an acting coach, and he was talking about Peter Kay. And I was saying, but I never understood. Peter Kay's just so quick with the ad libs and stuff like that. And he said, no, that's all rehearsed. He goes, everything that it's just so natural. And he's worked so hard at doing that, but it just seems seamless. But don't think that that's a natural thing, that his reaction. Do you know what I mean? But because it looks so natural, you take it for granted in so many ways. And it's when we're talking about Caroline Ahern, and it's very similar, that sort of northern humour and turning the jokes on us, but we're all laughing at each other. One of my favourite Peter Kay ones was the dog nonce. Well, remember that one?
Oh, Keith Laird, he got in trouble for that, didn't he? He had to do a disclaimer.
Did he really? Yeah.
You not seen it on that Peter Kay thing?
No.
He does the episode where it's Keith Laird turns up, the fire inspector, who's got a thing for dogs. and at the end, he gets arrested, doesn't he, for dog fooling. And then if you watch that Peter Kay thing, there's like an apology almost, saying this, because there's like a Keith Laird or Lord or something very similar. And it's like, this is not in any way a reference to.
Really?
Yeah. So he's obviously based it on someone. I'm not saying he's based the dog fiddling bit on it, but yeah. So he had to issue like an apology sort of thing, or an explanation, whatever you say, disclaimer. But yeah, he's just fucking brilliant. I just look, honestly, I love Peter Kay so much. And like, you know, they do that, like, there's a show on the BBC where they take all these bits of his shows, I forget what it's called, but like, they do bits of his shows, bits of his sitcoms and stuff, bits of his interviews that he's given, and they package it up into like an half an hour show. And it's just, he's just fucking fantastic. Whether he's on a chat show or he's in a sitcom or he's on stage, he's just got it. And he's just got it. Like you say, people think it's, you know, he's ad lib, but he just rehearses, he trains, you know, he goes into this. Yeah. I suppose people said, oh, you know, went to a pub and Peter Kay was performing, I couldn't believe it. And he was practicing his act, you know, and I love the stuff he does with the misheard song lyrics. Do you know what I mean? Like, it's amazing that, and we can all relate to that. My dad does that so many times when he's singing along to a song, and we can all get to that. And you know, or he plays the songs, you know, little clips of it, and he's like, what? Do you know what I mean? Like, just let me staple the vicar. Do you know what I mean? Yeah. When it's like, we are family, whatever. It's just amazing. He's just such a funny guy. And I could watch Peter Kay all day long.
Yeah, so I'm really bad for the misheard song lyrics. My worst one was, you know, I used to think the Smiths had a song called There Is a Light in Vivica's House. And I used to go up to like DJs in town, like, play Vivica's House, Vivica's House. Yeah, what are you on about, dickhead? I said, there is a light in Vivica's House. Who the fuck's Vivica?
It's not even a name.
Is it not? Exactly, but...
I can imagine that was a lot of fun, but you're loving that, you know, going, Vivica's House. Come on, play it now.
Yeah, and then singing along. Anyway.
Well, yeah, that's what I mean. He's just, you know, he's got it on it.
Yeah. Right, okay. My next one, I'll keep it a bit closer to home. Not British, as the Irish will kick my head in. And not many people that I know actually love this comedian as much as I do. And I think that's because his comedy is surrealist in many ways. And I think surrealist paintings, like, you either like Salvador Dali or you think it's fucking shit. And the next comedian is Dylan Moran. And for me, I just think he's his surreal observations on life, and especially as being a parent, is absolutely phenomenal. And I love his sort of mannerisms, where he's always smoking a fag and drinking a glass of wine. He plays like this aloof, drunken Dublin character. And so I'm pretty sure he's playing it up, like we were saying about Peter Kay and stuff. But it is such a natural thing. But he does so many jokes there. One of my favourite stand-ups. In fact, I probably watch more Dylan Moran stand-ups than I do any other comedian. He's got one called Monster that is just fucking hilarious. And he goes about kids being, kids, what are kids? They're nothing but midget drunks. He goes, they knee you in the morning when they wake up and they don't do anything you tell them. He goes, try and tell a kid to do anything. He's like, no. It's like getting a drunk in the bath. No. And then hipsters. He goes, organic. I grew up at Angel Delight. We didn't have anything in the house if it wasn't neon. And then there's like I was thinking earlier on when I knew we were doing this. What do you, you know, like when your people say, what sort of music are you into? And you can sort of give them a genre. It's difficult with comedy, isn't it? When people say, what sort of comedians are you into? And I really like ones that are sort of quite philosophical, like I was saying with Bill Hicks, and always sort of have a message. And one of my favorite Dylan Moran bits is where he goes about fulfill your potential. Don't do it. Stay away from your potential. You'll mess it up. It's potential. Leave it. Anyway, it's like your bank balance. You've always got more than you ever have.
go on.
Yeah, no, and I just think he's hilarious. He's loads of, like, it is very surreal. He'll talk about toothless simpletons in Ireland and stuff. And he goes, has lots of digs at this Catholic church. And then it's hard to describe, but if you can watch Monster, and it is available on YouTube, you'll really, really enjoy it. And like I would say to a lot of my mates, Dylan Moran's hilarious, and they only know him from like Black Books, which is, I think, pretty funny. I don't know if you're into Black Books, the comedy series he did.
I've not really watched it, mate. I know I should do, because I've heard like loads about it, and like yourself, yeah. My mates have been like, oh yeah, you should watch it.
I think people see it as being quite a student-y sort of comedy, you know, like the Young Ones was, so that sort of thing. But his stand-up is hilarious. Definitely check out Monster. It's just so, so funny. That's my next one.
It's mad because I don't know a lot about Dylan. I think I've seen him once or twice where he's talking about babies and stuff, and it was really funny. And I've seen him, obviously, he was in, he's been in a couple of Simon Pegg films, and he was in Shaun of the Dead.
Yeah,
I think Run, Fat Boy, Run as well. I think he was in that.
Yeah.
And you can see he's a funny guy. His timing is perfect. And, you know, even in a role in Shona there that's not particularly likeable, he's still funny. I'm glad you picked him, like, because he's someone like I don't really know a lot on. I'll go and check out Monster, because I remember years ago watching a bit of his stand-up and finding really funny. But he's one of those I've not really revisited. I think probably because I don't really watch Black Books or anything like that, where he's in it a lot, so you think, oh
yeah, detach you too, because I mean it's the stuff when he's a parent, when as being a parent, which we might not have found funny 8-10 years ago, but now we're like, oh, I don't do drugs. If I needed a rush I'll just stand up too quickly.
To relate to that,
yeah, and it's just like lots of commentary on being overweight and underpaid and underloved in your house as a father. So we can both attach ourselves to that.
Seriously, mate, that is like, he's got a camera in our house. Yeah, 100%. I'll go and check him out. Actually, so Monster, is it? Yeah,
yeah.
I'll check that out as a starting point. Obviously, check out his other stuff. Good stuff. For the next one, I'm going to choose someone who is arguably the greatest of all time. He's not my greatest of all time. I'll get to mine in a little while, but he's not far off it. Massively influential, massively funny, not underrated, just one of the greatest stand-up comedians in history, and it's Richard Pryor. I mean, the thing with Richard Pryor is he's just sort of he changed so many things in comedy the way he was. I mean, first sort of black comedy superstar, the first one who could sell out like a big arena or have a TV special that was, you know, global, have a cinematic release like Live on Sunset Strip, which made loads of money. But Richard Pryor, he was just so raw in the way he did his comedy. He could just put it all out there. I mean, Richard Pryor had a bit of a, well, a bit is an understatement. He had a massively chaotic life. He was married about five times, I think. He was addicted to crack cocaine. He set himself on fire once when he was freebasing cocaine. And yet he was abused as a kid. And yet he would literally go on stage and talk about all these things and make them hilarious. He would go on stage and talk about setting himself on fire and joke about it, and it'd be you couldn't help but stop. You couldn't stop laughing, and he had that ability that all the great comedians have of being able to talk about quite dark subjects and making you laugh, and being able to talk about nonsense. Being able to talk about, you know, Richard Pryor. You know, you love The Godfather. The bit he does about The Godfather. You know, when Tessio says, "Can you just get me off with it for old time's sake?" and he's just like. And he says, you can see Tessio in the car going, "Hey, Danny, do you remember when I taught you how to drive?" Trying to beg his way out of it. "Hey, Sal, do you remember when I bought you your first gun?" "No, Tessio. No, Sal. No." Yeah, just little things like that. You know, when he's telling these little bits about The Godfather or going to Africa and the lions, you know, just jokes about the lions.
Oh, God, yeah.
You know, yeah, bring your camcorder, bring your camera. We're going to eat all that shit. You know, like that, like the lions like that. It's just like, just, and then he'll talk about, you know, fighting with his wife and nearly killing her, or, you know, his wife leaving him because he can't get off drugs and his friend's trying to get him off him and he's just not listening. And it's tragic, but it's hilarious. And he was like the first comedian that really did all that and just broke the mold. And it's like, the sad part for me about Richard Pryor is, obviously, you know, he wasn't well before he died. He had MS. I mean, even that he turned into a joke. He said, "When I found out I had multiple sclerosis, I thought, what the fuck is that?" Do you know what I mean? He was just like, just turned into a joke. And it's like, you know, he never quite had the film career he deserved. If you look at some of his films, I mean, he was in a couple of decent films. He was in Stir Crazy, which is okay. I think it's a little bit overrated, if I'm being honest. And See No Evil, Hear No Evil, which has good moments in it. I don't think as a whole film it's that great, but it has some funny moments. But he never quite had the film career he deserved. You know, like Eddie Murphy had these great vehicles for his talents. Richard Pryor, if you look at some of his comedy films like Critical Condition, Moving, they're just not very good. They don't do him any justice. His best film's probably Blue Collar, which is a drama, Paul Schrader drama. And then, you know, he was in Superman 3, I think. And he got paid, I think he got paid $5 million for it. And he said, you know, for a piece of shit, it smells great, because it was just a terrible film, but he got paid a lot of money to do it. So he did it. And the sad thing for me with this is, when he did work with Eddie Murphy wrote a role for him in Harlem Nights, which should have been, you know, the perfect sort of storm of talent. Eddie Murphy, Richard Pryor, Red Fox is in it as well. Eddie Murphy wrote it. Eddie Murphy was coming off the back of hit after hit after hit after hit, and this was his first flop in like a decade. It just doesn't quite work. And then Richard Pryor physically wasn't well as well, because obviously he's MS, and he wasn't really able to do many more roles. But as a stand-up comedian, I mean, he's just fucking brilliant. One of his shows is on Netflix. And he's just sort of talking about, you know, he bought a couple of squirrel monkeys. He talks about them, talks about everything. He makes jokes with the audience. Do you know what I mean? Like, just, he's just so funny. He's hilarious. And he brought the mold, and people like Eddie Murphy and others just followed in his footsteps. And, you know, when you listen to Chappelle or Kevin Hart or everyone, they all talk, not just black comedians, but everyone, you know, they all talk about Richard Pryor, because there's a reason why everyone reveres it. You know, you talk about sort of the comedian. I know we keep saying that, but with Richard Pryor, so many comedians refer to him as being the one that made them want to take up comedy, because he was just brutal, but brutal on himself. He never picked on anyone. He never, you know, some comedians will tell, like Eddie Murphy will hammer everyone.
Yeah.
Do you know what I mean? He will hammer Michael Jackson, Mr. T, Stevie Wonder. Do you know what I mean? Like, just brutal. But with Richard Pryor, it was always introverted. He was always like self-deprecating. He was just taking a piss out of himself. Do you know what I mean? And it was just like, he's just hilarious with it. And it's always tinged with a little bit of tragedy, because you know his life isn't great in a way that, you know, he has all these problems, his issues, his drugs and his relationships, and you know how it pans out, but it's just so funny. And I just think for many of people, even our age and younger, they probably don't know a lot about him, probably never even seen his stand-up, and you should just definitely check him out, because it doesn't matter how old you are, it's all relevant, you know, jokes about just life or whatever, and jokes by himself are just funny. They stand the test of time, they really do. And I think there's a reason Richard Pryor is so revered. He's just absolute top of the comedy tree.
Yeah, Richard Pryor's impressions are probably one of my funniest ones. He's not doing characters as such, but he's taking off people. And I always love the sort of the white man's voice that Richard Pryor used to always. Oh yeah, that's always hilarious.
He does, so hello. Oh no, I can't do it. Scottish. Yeah, I can't do it. He's not Scottish, Richard Pryor.
Our numbers are going up in the north, I tell you.
Mate, seriously. It's either Geordie or Scottish if you're a Texan or a white guy in America. But yeah, he does it. Yeah, he does it. It's funny because, like, Chappelle does a similar thing. He has a white guy voice, doesn't he?
Yeah.
Like, yeah, but yeah, he's hilarious. Honestly, Richard Pryor, I love him, man.
Have you ever read his, have you read Pryor Convictions?
I haven't, you know. I know you've recommended it to me, and I haven't.
It's tragic, mate. It's proper, like you were saying, he's very self-deprecating, and where Peter Kay will talk about certain, the lighter moments of his personal life. Like, Richard Pryor lays everything bare. And you just see, when you've seen, is it Live on Sunset Boulevard? And that's
Live
one
Sunset
of the...
Sunset Strip, yeah.
Sunset Strip. When you've watched that, you think, that can't possibly be true. But then when you actually read Pryor Convictions, you're like, fuck, he grew up in a brothel. Like, yeah. You know, he was surrounded by pimps and stuff like that. He was sexually abused as a child and shit. There's actually rumours of him and Marlon Brando actually bumping uglies. I'm not too sure how true that is, so don't assume Brando or Pryor family, but I think it was one of Brando's wives is releasing a book or something, and there's some sort of thing there. I don't know.
It's just reminding me that. Sorry, it's just reminding me. I mean, this is slightly off topic, but... It's almost tragic because, you know, he wrote Blazing Saddles with Mel Brooks.
Mm-hmm.
And Mel Brooks, you know, the Black Sheriff part would have been his, but the studio wouldn't approve it because he's had so many drug problems at the time. They're just like, not a chance. And Mel Brooks said it's the same because he, you know, that could have been a role for him that would have been perfect. And that would have been a film that did him justice as well.
Yeah.
Because, it's a good film. It's a funny film. And he wrote it. He wrote that part and he wrote a lot of it, but it was just like... Like you say, with the tragedy, there's just so much of it in his life. It's just chaos. Do you know what I mean? From an early age to his death. You know, he went through it all, didn't he? Really, so many marriages, so many drug problems, arrests, just all sorts. Do you know what I mean?
Yeah.
But all the time, you root for him.
Yeah, you do. He feels like. His whole life story is like the underdog, and every time he's sort of getting ahead of the tragedy, something else will happen. I mean, so Ali, the drugs and stuff was his own undoing, but you know, he come from such humble or devastating beginnings to being put on such a pedestal. And like this scenes where he's talking about how much cocaine he was going through and using and stuff, and it's like, you know, from literally from rags to riches to tragedy. But it's one of the best biographies I've read. It's so good. Yeah, really, really good. Pryor Convictions. Right, I'm going to move on to my next one. And I'm a bit nervous about talking about this one because of the whole Me Too movement. But if we're going to be honest, as we should be, is that Louis C.K. Was, for me, in the top five comedians. Now, we've had the conversation before about whether we're allowed to enjoy anybody's art after you found out what a wanker they are. But I was listening to this. I didn't even mean to play on the pun there.
You've even put a plant behind you.
Oh mate, I really didn't. That was great. I'm so good. So obviously the whole Me Too movement. But I was listening to the Morrissey album the week, and I thought I can listen to the Smiths, regardless of Morrissey's political leanings. I can still enjoy Louis C.K. But I think the whole Me Too movement, when you go back and sort of revisit his comedy, it's not a surprise because he portrays himself as being this miserable, seedy, fucking depressed bloke. Do you know what I mean? On stage, it isn't a surprise that he was the sort of bloke who'd be get done for fucking masturbating in front of colleagues or forcing them to do certain things. But he was the closest thing to Bill Hicks, I think. I thought that he had like political commentary, but again, the sort of, I don't know what genre you put it in, but it was like a miserabilist. I think sometimes, you know, that was probably the way to sort of describe Louis C.K. I've not really gone into his stuff post the scandal. But there's like, again, as being a dad, and he goes about, have you seen the bit where he does about parents and when you ever see a kid screaming at a parent in a supermarket, and then you get these people who go like, oh, the poor kid, what's the mother done? And he goes, I think fucking bastard kid, what's it? I feel for that poor parent, you know, because like, you don't know, man, you haven't got kids, you don't understand. And then there's a bit, he does a brilliant bit about going on a vacation. And he, I think it's in the Chewed Up DVD. And he says that, yeah, so the family's all going on vacation. We've got 2 weeks away. Get the kids in the car, put the suitcases in. And what I always do is I walk around the long way around the car to get to the driver's side, because that's the only fucking break I'll get for the next for the next 2 weeks. And it's true. You can take away the whole Me Too stuff, because it was disgusting and stuff. But he's like, he's so bang on in terms of the... just the analysis, I think, of stuff like that. And I mean, let me know how you feel about, not Louis C.K., but can you enjoy his comedy once you've realised that he liked to wank over, you know, employees against their will or with their will? I don't know, Louis. Don't sack me. But I didn't know whether I'm allowed to talk about that. But to be honest,
Listen, I mean, it's weird because Jerry Seinfeld was on Colbert one day, and he said he could still listen to Bill Cosby. And then they went to a commercial. And when he came back, he changed his mind and said, actually, I can't. Now, I don't know whether someone had a word in his ear or whether he just reflected on it and thought, but Bill Cosby, you know, we're going to, I mean, any sort of abuse is bad, but Bill Cosby was a lot worse than what Louis C.K. was doing or accused of. But Chappelle sort of defends him a little bit in one of his more recent specials. Because he makes the money and he says, like, listen, I'm not defending what he did, but because there was, like, women who said he ruined my dream. And he's saying, like, I'm not being funny. If someone masturbating in front of you ruins your dream, was it really a dream? You know, if that had happened to Martin Luther King, would he have said, I have a dream, but someone wanks in front of me, so I'm not got it anymore?
Yeah.
I don't know. And it's like, oh, Dave, but, you know, it's a weird one because Louis C.K. isn't quite a pariah. Like, I think there's been some pushback on it, but I think he's back in touring again, isn't he? Or he's performing.
Yeah, I mean, I don't think he'll ever reach the heights that he did. And I know Netflix pulled his special, but the people that were speaking out around him, like I know Sarah Silverman as well, who was really good mates, and she actually said that Louis used to do it in front of me all the time. Do you know what I mean? I know it had been going on for a while. I mean, I don't want to turn this into whether we're defending or
no, I get that. You've got to tread carefully because it is abuse. And to be honest with you, regardless of what you're standing, it's fucking odd.
But that's what I mean. But he actually he makes like he says that sort of stuff in his comedy about how like sexually depraved he is or because he's not getting any sort of stuff. He goes, I used to have like go back to my hotel room and I'd have like Dunkin' Donuts, and if I wank and I just wake up in Shane Glaze. Do you know what
it's like? Have you seen where he does like the world's saddest hand job with his wife?
Yeah.
And he says about he had to get her hand and he's in the kids' room. And he's like, it's fucking my house. The kids weren't there. Stop being judgmental. And he's like, he basically had hold of his missus' hand. And he said it's like the world's saddest hand job.
And that's what he talks about. Yeah, he talks about wanking all the time.
Yeah, it's funny at the time. Now you're looking at it, you go, and it's that thing in your brain, and he's like, this is a bit like what he got done for.
He goes about trying to find somewhere. He goes, he got a house full of wife and kids trying to find somewhere to have a wank. He goes, and I'm in my shed like a little troll.
Did you see him on Saturday Night Live? I'm sure it was when he did Saturday Night Live, when he talked about child abusers.
No fucking hell.
I'm sure it's Saturday Night Live. And he was like, child abusers must really love it. Like, I'm not being funny, I'm not defending it, but he's saying like, he says, I love chocolate ice cream, but if someone, or he says some sort of sweet, but if I knew that eating chocolate ice cream was going to send me to prison for the rest of my life, I would never eat it again. but they do that, knowing full well it's going to ruin their lives. And it's like, everyone's like that, and he goes, he tells all his chocolate, and he goes, at the end he goes, we got through it, everyone. We got through that bit. We got through it. And you're like, oh my God.
Fuck you.
That's what I mean. He's so like,
he's not close
on the edge, you know what I mean? And that is good comedy, and I think I like that. Do you know what I mean? And some people, it's not for them, but for me, it is. I can find that.
Yeah.
The trouble is now it's tainted. Some of it is slightly tainted because you think, yes, being seedy and self-deprecating, and you know, you're a bit of a weirdo, and it's funny. But when you've got women saying, "Oh, he made me do stuff" or whatever,
yeah, of course,
it loses it a little bit for me personally. And it's like now it's not as funny. Now it is a bit just wrong. Do you know what I mean? But I get where you're coming from, because I don't think this is Cosby levels of that's it. Do you know what I mean? Because Bill Cosby went out and fucking raping women for years, and it's like, oh my god, especially from Bill Cosby, who was literally Mr. You know, he toured the America talking about young black men have a responsibility to act better. Do you know what I mean? Well, fucking hell. And it was when he did it in his stand-up that led to him getting prosecuted. But with Louis C.K., it's different. And you know, like I said, he's rebuilding his career. So it'll be interesting to see how it pans out. And there are elements of the Me Too movement which were necessary. There are elements that went OTT in some respect.
Yeah.
And, you know, I think that some of the things that were claimed, I'm not saying that's the case with him. I think it's just for that time, for what he did, people weren't going to stomach it. So, it's from a comedy point of view, it's a shame because...
Yeah.
You know, it, like you say, he's supposed to, but he is a very, very funny guy. And that was the things he's spoken about. The problem is fucking life imitated art probably a little bit too much.
Yeah, I agree with you. Just before we go on, actually, because we spoke a lot like the Black Lives Matter movement, and Louis C.K. did I think it was an article about the N-word, and he says he hates when people like news presenters or anyone says the N word, and he goes, "Well, now you just made me fucking say it in my head." He goes, "How dare you? How dare you make me say it?" And for all that sort of stuff, he was quite outspoken on like rights movements, which is quite ironic, you know, given the context of what actually happened. But one of his jokes was, "How many advantages can one person have? I'm a white man, do you know?" And that was
he was man, and it's weird because he's a liberal voice, and yet his attitudes towards women obviously weren't quite as liberal as his persona. It's weird because that's obviously a little bit different, but I think when you look at a lot of comedians, there's different elements to it. You know, like I was talking about Eddie Murphy and talking about how you have to look past some of the homophobic jokes and remember the time and the era and the fact he's apologised to him, but they're not comfortable to watch. If you watch Delirious, that first 5 minutes, he's dropping the F-bomb, and I don't mean, the homophobic slur, not the F-word, left, right, and centre, and he's making these crass sort of comments, and you're like, you know. But, he moves on, thankfully. It's weird because, I've seen a lot of female comedians speaking out about this recently, even about the sort of the molesting, the stuff that went on in the comedy clubs and getting their asses felt and people try and, I think Joe Rogan, then he got in a bit of trouble not so long ago.
Yeah.
One of it was old footage from the Joe Rogan Experience a few years ago, when someone was talking about making female comedians give them a blowjob to go up on stage. And he was like giggling along with it. And then, it didn't get him cancelled, but that's the sort of thing that can do. So it's obviously there's a seedy side to this sort of the comedy circuit, and it's a shame. But then, that seediness, when it's done, when he's in the right way about it, is what makes Louis C.K. such a funny guy. And he's a naturally funny guy. He talks about all sorts of stuff. And he talks about stuff that a lot of Americans don't like to talk about as well. Do you know what I mean? Like, he owns it. He does. And it'll be interesting to see whether he recovers from it. He really will.
Yeah, I agree. Over to you, mate.
My penultimate one is, we were talking, me and you last night, weren't we, about who we were going to choose. And again, I have to go back to comedians that I've loved throughout my life. And one that for about, I don't know, probably about 10 years, whatever, who I always loved to watch his stand-up was Billy Connolly. Just a really funny guy. And my mum and dad have always been into Billy Connolly. And I was a bit like, you were talking about earlier, that thing where you're not as into it because your parents are, you're like, whatever. But he's just hilarious, and some of his stand-up routines and his jokes. There was just and on, you know, he's obviously famous for doing chat shows as well and stuff. And I know he did films, but you know, with sort of varied success. I mean, he did some good dramatic roles with Mrs. Brown. Was
Mrs. Brown's Boys, yeah.
Not Mrs. Brown's Boys, for God's sake.
Was he not in that long? We'll cut that out.
No, we won't. Mrs. Brown's Boys, I'll tell you what.
He was playing a Jordan. Yeah. I thought I got that right. I had Steve Coogan wrote Philomena and fucking Billy Connolly starred in Mrs. Brown's Boys.
Sex doesn't sound like Anton Deck. I can't say anything. My accent was as bad as yours. But Billy Connolly, you know, as a standard comedian for a spell, I mean, he's not well now, he's retired. And again, towards the end, there was a little bit of sort of almost like a bit of a fallout. He wasn't someone who was quite able, I felt, to, once he was amazingly successful, to always get away with the everyman sort of shtick or whatever. But when he saw some of his jokes and growing up in Scotland and some of the stuff that went on and the shipyards and stuff and all that, and, like, you know, just the bits he used to do, you know, the stuff with his... You know, he's like, I remember this came up the other day. His uncle, who was in a Japanese prisoner of war camp, and he's saying he'd always be grabbing loaves of bread off the table, and your mum and dad would be eating, you tell him just ignore him. Do you know, just little things like that, or when he talk about when, you know, in the shipyards, when they, just before finishing time, they used to let out all the people that were used to work in the shipyard who were mentally not well. And they'd all sort of come running, like, and when he does it, he's just like, you cry and laugh. It's completely un PC.
Yeah.
It's hilarious. And he had that ability. And I saw him do a bit about one of the more recent ones, you know, talk about suicide bombing. And he's saying, you know, imagine being, you know, the suicide bombing teacher at the school. I'm only going to show you this once. And he's like, what the fuck is that about?
I've never heard that one before. Yeah. Fucking
hell. Like, he made that funny. Do you know what I mean? Just a stand-up comedian who for a good, 30 years probably.
Oh, mate, yeah.
Yeah, if not longer, was just one of the greats. Went over to America, smashed it there as well. You know, was a massive success at stand-up and on the chat show circuit. Got had his own show for a little while. Didn't quite work out. But, and a film career. Just a hugely funny guy and another one who's good influence on other comedians. And, you know, Billy Connolly's just like a tour de force, wasn't he, really? He was just like, you know, Billy Connolly, you know, he was always good box office, whether he was on a chat show or whether it was stand-up, he was always guaranteed to laugh, and he did some of the things he no matter what he was talking about, he could talk about women, he could talk about shampoo. I've seen him do stuff about shampoo. It's just hilarious. Just a naturally... Yeah. Hilarious guy,
great musician as well. His songs are really funny. I've actually shared a stage with Billy Connolly.
Really?
When I graduated from university, Michael Parkinson was the chancellor of my uni. So on the day when you sort of pick up your certificate and stuff, there was Billy Connolly was there and Dame Judi Dench on the same stage.
You've done all right there.
I always remember Billy Connolly doing this speech at the end, and he was like, you know, when they give advice to students and stuff, and I can't find it anywhere online, but he said the Tories have got in, stay where you are, stay in academia, because it's fucking shite out there. Everyone's just Michael Parkinson doesn't know where to look. And Dame Judi Dench actually is, you know, she's a very shy person and don't really like speaking in public unless she's actually an actor. She was pissing herself laughing. But yeah, he was there in his tartan pants. And for me, Billy Connolly was always, he's a raconteur. And I know he actually went on stage loads of times, and he stopped drinking quite early on, you know, like our good selves. And he actually struggled. He didn't know where it was. It was laying a pressure on him, and he didn't know whether he could do it sober or drunk. His missus, his book, Pamela Stevenson's on the biography of Billy Connolly, is really good as well. And again, another tragic upbringing in terms of like his family and stuff like that. And again, unfortunately, he wasn't the one who was sexually abused, but that's a fantastic book. And it's proper damaged character, but you know, I mean, everybody loves it. I don't know anybody who doesn't love Billy Connolly. We throw around the sort of, the phrase that they're a national treasure. I mean, Scotland's its own country, but you know, for these islands, he really is. Do you know what I mean? And like I said, for 30 years, he was by far the fucking greatest stand-up on these shows.
100%, mate. 100%. He really was. You're right. And, you know, it's tragic now that he's not well, and obviously he can't perform and everything. I think, I think it's Alzheimer's or dementia. I might be wrong, but he's got,
is it Alzheimer's or Parkinson's? Is it Parkinson's?
It might be Parkinson's disease. Let me just have a check because I don't want to get it wrong because obviously, just bear with me. I just can't think that. Trying to find it here now. Parkinson's disease. Yeah.
Tragic. The documentary that BBC did on him was really good, and I think a lot of people. So I think Michael Parkinson himself actually came out and said that he's living his last days, and then Pamela Stevenson put a video of him up on Twitter of him playing banjo by a river, saying by a lake, saying Billy's all right. But I'm gonna go to my next one because I know who the last one is, and I really want to spend a lot of time on that. But I was saying that Monster is probably the one I watched the most for Dylan Moran. My last comedian, their live album. I remember having a bootleg copy of it, Bigger and Blacker by Chris Rock. I rinsed that album. It had skits by Old Dirty Bastard in it and stuff. But I used to remember having this Discman and getting the 192 to and from work and just absolutely hammering this, and then just pissing yourself laughing, no one else around you could obviously see what you're laughing at, and must have looked like a lunatic. But it got me a free space on the a free space on the bus. But Chris Rock, he's just fucking. I know he's coming next, and then them two are probably on a par for me in terms of where the greatest. I think the one you're going to talk about maybe during the current moment, you know, is probably excelled Chris, but his commentary again was very much on social commentary from a black experience, especially during the 90s, and it was all like that hip hop sort of when hip hop was like the golden age the golden age of hip hop, and it's so many jokes. There's one like he goes about, I took the AIDS test, passed, got 65%. And he goes, you take the AIDS test and you're reflecting on every stinking ass bit of pussy that you've fucked over the years, and like that night in Ohio, what was I thinking? You know, start reflecting on everything, and anybody who's had to go to the STD clinic, they've gone through similar experiences to try, to have them thoughts running through the head. But there's another one where he goes in about the best quote that was always on that and got me in so much trouble in a relationship that I was in during the time with a bunny boiler, but was, a man is only as faithful as his options. And I was like, oof. Yeah. And then when your girlfriend at the time finds you pissing yourself laughing at that, I'm like, what are you laughing at?
It's not good.
And then he does one about chasing sex, and he goes, why do men always try and chase sex? And it's something along the lines of men have been chasing women for, it got, no, so these two people are having a conversation about why men go after sex and women don't. He goes like, because he goes, because ever since the age of 14, when you had a pair of breasts, everyone's been trying to fuck you. Do you know what I mean? He goes, nobody's, he goes, you've not had to chase sex, but if someone's chasing a man for sex, he can't run fast enough. Like, oh shit, you got me.
he's like a, don't use the word lightly, but he's a bit of a genius, isn't he, Chris Rock?
Oh, legend, absolutely. I seen him at the arena last year, the year before, on the post-divorce, is it called the boomerang tour, where he's supposed to bounce back or whatever, and he's talking about his divorce and stuff like that, and he does a bit about a woman keeping tabs on what a man's up to. He said, you always got to make sure you're working. He goes, even now, Michelle Obama's like, what the fuck? Hurry up with that book. Like, where's the money?
That's what I mean, man. There's so many funny bits that Chris Rock has done. You know, I love it when he's taking the piss out of, the adverts for medicine. Is that on Bigger and Blacker? Where he says, they're always trying to get you to have that pill, aren't they? He says, I saw one advert that says, do you go to bed at night and wake up in the morning? Yeah, that's me. I need that pill.
Or, fucking hilarious.
When he says the difference between black guys and the N-word, and he says, like, the N-word, and he'll say, like, I ain't never been to jail. You're not supposed to, you dickhead. Or, I look after my kids. That's your fucking job.
Oh, wait, where he's painting the picture of the difference of the white experience and the black experience of going to the supermarket. And he goes like, you go to the black supermarket and you get your fucked up shopping trolley, won't roll straight. It's like, you get your fucked up meat and whacking the flies off it. And you go, and then you go to the white mall and then you roll in and he goes like, fresh produce.
Have you ever seen it where he talks about anti-Semitism? Black people and anti-Semitism?
Maybe, I can't remember.
He says, black people don't hate Jews. He says, we ain't got time to be differentiating between which types of white people we don't like.
Because he goes, biggest racists on the earth are all black men. He goes, cracker, cracker, ass, cracker.
He's a cheat, honestly, mate. He's so, you know what? If you hadn't picked him, mate, yeah, I would have. He's just, I remember, I watched, I think it might be Big and Black. I can't remember one of his stand ups. I was at a convention years ago and they had a cinema there and it was on in the cinema. And it was just fucking brilliant. I was just crying, laughing, honestly. And the way he delivers his jokes as well, he's so full of energy in it. And it's weird because he's like, he's proper close to the bone, isn't he, Chris Rock? Yeah, he's hosted the Oscars and stuff like that, and it's like, how the fuck has that happened? Do you know what I mean? Like, where you almost have to be cleaning and clean now to get that gig. But he has done it, and, he's done, like, loads of MTV Awards and stuff, and he is raw, and he's just the way he delivers stuff, and he's just hilarious, man. He is. I could watch fucking Chris Rock all day. And like you say, still going now, he's still doing stand up. I've seen it now. Netflix, we've got some, I think.
He seems to be that rare beast that's moved into the. I know Chappelle is a little bit, but that's been able to do films and then still remain at the peak of his come out. You know, it doesn't seem to have affected his comedy as much. Whereas I know some people, when they move up, we talk about Eddie Murphy, move over into films, they find it hard to sort of balance the both. But yeah, he's just been scathing and he's fucking hilarious. One of my favorite jokes is when the trench coat mafia thing came out and he goes, I'm more scared nowadays of white kids than black kids. He goes, if I get into an elevator, if I'm in an elevator and five white kids jumping, I'm jumping the fuck up.
So I mean, like, things like that, honestly, only he can fucking see that and get away with it and be like that. He's just fucking brilliant. No, Chris Rock, he's up there in the conversation of the GOATs. Do you know what I mean?
Definitely.
Like, I would put him above, like, I know I chose Eddie Murphy, but I'd put him above Murphy, somewhere around the sort of Richard Pryor levels. I just think he's
consistency, wasn't it? I think.
Yeah, over the years, and he has, and he's always been able to be a good voice. But yeah.
Right, go.
You know me, you know, anyone who's ever watched this podcast will know the man I'm always quoting, who I absolutely adore. For me, the funniest, the greatest of all time. A true comedian, and artist, and it's Dave Chappelle. And I think the guy is just fucking absolutely gifted. He absolutely lives for his craft, unlike other people. He's dedicated himself to stand-up, absolutely dedicated himself, and he's an important voice right now as well. I mean, you know, you look at Chappelle's career, he had the most successful sketch show in America, was offered $50 million to do a third series after earning fuck all for the first two series, and walked away from it. He said no, because it was like, he didn't have control, he didn't like what he was doing, he felt that people were laughing at him, not with him. And he went to South Africa, and just spent time there. And then, you know, he took almost a decade hiatus. But he's always done stand-up. You know, he might not have always made films. He has made films, but he might have had a break from Hollywood and TV and stuff. But he's just absolutely dedicated to his stand-up. And he's, you know, he's the type of guy that, you know, other comedians will say that they'll be in a show in Denver and he'll have turned up. And he does stuff like he drove across America or rode across America. And when he'd go from like he was on a bike, I think, him and a few mates. And when he was running out of money, he just stopped and put on a show. And he said, you know, he did like the block party thing where he put on a show in the street. He'd do stuff like he'd take a PA system with him and do shows in the park. Do you know what I mean? He's just obsessed with doing comedy, just wants to do comedy, not asked about the money, not asked about that, just wants to be, you know, wants to go out there and just make comedy and be the biggest, you know, as good a comedian as he can be. And he's had a bit of I don't know if you can say it, a rejuvenation or renaissance slightly now, because there was a time when, you know, people almost dismissed Chappelle because he can, again, he can be quite edgy and quite to the bone. Obviously, he got himself into a little bit of trouble with the transgender community, which he addresses in his latest stand-up. But especially in the Black Lives Matter moment, his latest special, 8:46, I mean, he says it himself, it's not even really funny. He's more or less just... talking about the issues and what's going on and the George Floyd killing. And he's just a powerful voice as well. And what I like about Chappelle is he's hilarious. You know, he can tell jokes and he can do bits that are just will have you crying with laughter. You know, and he handles some pretty sort of heavy subjects. You know, he can talk about Michael Jackson having kids around and make it funny, and you're laughing, and you're crying laughing, and yet it's like parties. Yeah, it's like, what? Michael Jackson sucked my dick. And it's like, what? But, you know, it's like...
what's the bit where he says that, where is it? He goes, can you imagine going back into school the next day saying, the kid, was it the king of pop sucked my wee-wee?
Yeah, he goes, how was your weekend, Tim? He goes, my weekend? Michael Jackson sucked my dick. If that's my first sexual experience, the sky's the limit.
And it shouldn't be funny, but it's so
weird. It's like, it's so funny. It's like when he talks about meeting OJ Simpson. Have you seen that?
He does a bit. The three times he meets OJ.
And the one he meets him after he's allegedly done the murder, and his wife or whoever says, how can you shake that man's hand? He's a murderer. And he says, honey, that murderer ran for over 11,000 yards.
Oh, man.
It's so raw, but it's so funny. And the thing that I love about Chappelle, this is what elevates him for me to the greatest. He tells things, he says important, he addresses important issues, and he throws in truth bombs in the middle of his stand-up. You know, I saw a stand-up he did not long ago, and halfway through, he started talking about Emmett Till and how, you know, Emmett Till was a black kid who was from Chicago, I think, went to visit his parents in the South, family in the South. A white woman accused him of wolf whistling at her, and he was executed. And then on a deathbed, she admitted she made it up. And he talks about how her mum, he says, Emmett Till's mum was a gangster. And she basically, you know, it was like a catalyst for some of the civil rights movement. And he throws that in the middle of a stand-up where he's just been telling the dick and the fart jokes and the jokes that are like raw. And then all of a sudden, telling that, you know, in his recent one at 8:46, he talks about Christopher Dorner, you know, the copper who went mad and waging a war about, you know, against the LAPD and how, like, you know, Christopher Dorner had this manifesto. And in his manifesto, he spoke about how he loved Chappelle. And he makes a joke like, he says, like, the LAPD rang me and said, you need any protection. He's saying, hell, he likes me. I'm okay. It's you that needs protection. Do you know what I mean? For me, that's a gift to be able to go from the light and the dark, to tell your point, to get important points across that mean a lot and that make people think. Do you know what I mean? And then be able to revert back to the comedy and just to do it. Saturday Night Live was an example. You know, Trump's just been elected, and there's a lot of people, and even myself, I remember when Trump got elected, you know, we're in the UK, and I was shocked, and I was disappointed, and I was a little bit worried, because this guy's, you know, for me, he's racist, he's an idiot, he's going to be harmful to the world, and you can only imagine what a lot of Americans were feeling. And Dave Chappelle was scheduled to do Saturday Night Live, and he did Saturday Night Live, and if you watch that stand-up he does, and he talks about going to the White House, he talks about the disenfranchised being given an opportunity. And he says, you know, all we ask, we're going to give you a chance, and all we ask is that you do the same for us, because if you don't, you know, you may be sorry, sort of thing. And it was so powerful, and he just sort of summed it up for everyone that was that scared. Yeah. That, but you know what? Let's give this president a chance, and let's, you know, we're asking him to do the same for us. Obviously, that's not fucking... And he addresses that. He says, you know, I wasn't sticking up for him. And, you know, whichever way you look at it, he's doing a terrible job. But, you know, that was just... That's the gift that Chappelle has. He's able to do that. And he does stick up for a lot of the comedians. He stuck up for Kevin Hart when he was going through his stuff. He stuck up for Louis C.K. slightly. He's a little bit less sticking up for him, but just being honest that he's his friend sort of thing. But, you know, the Kevin Hart stuff, when Kevin Hart got pulled from the Oscars, you know, he says he's against this cancel culture thing. Do you know what I mean? And he said it's just getting fucking ridiculous. And he's not afraid of that. He's not going to bow down to that. He's, you know, his comedy is the way it is. And he hasn't changed it. He hasn't watered it down, and he won't. And I think he almost transcends it, where he's above it all in a way. Do you know what I mean? It's like he's not just a comedian. He's more than that. And I just people probably get sick of me talking about him because I just fucking love him.
No, yeah. I mean, I spoke about Bill Hicks at the beginning, but Dave Chappelle, for me, is the greatest of all time, easily. And I think that one word that always, for me, sums it up, and I don't think you can associate it that much with comedians, is integrity. And that's what that's what Dave Chappelle has, a lot of integrity and to the craft. And he loves it as an art form and treats it like Picasso with a painting. That's how he treats comedy. And I think a lot of people look at it as, like, you know, it's a few laughs for a few bucks, sort of, you know, it's a career sort of thing. But for him, it's a lasting, you know, it's a legacy. But he uses his pedestal to talk about serious subjects, and he can put light and dark on it, like you said. But what have you watched, the Mark Twain thing, where he received the Mark Twain Award? If anyone has any doubt about how great Dave Chappelle is as a comedian, then you watch, I think it's like 60 minutes long. I think it's on Netflix now.
Yeah,
it's where he receives his Mark. It's where he receives the Mark Twain Award for comedy, and how all his peers talk about him. You know what I mean? Kevin Hart recently was on the Joe Rogan show, and he was saying that once he'd seen Dave, I think it was before the 8:46 one, but he said the one where he was talking about the Louis C.K. goes, me and Chris Rock had to rip up our scripts because our stand-ups, because we didn't know where to go with it. And because Chappelle has, like you said, just transcended. I don't see how anyone can sort of try and go, you can't top that. It's godly. Do you know what I mean? It's all encompassing. It is funny. It is dark. It is social commentary. It isn't afraid. Do you know what I mean? In what to talk about. And the whole thing about going to Africa because of his... Mate, if anybody can turn down £50 million to that just shows, because that just shows how much he loves his craft, and that he'll turn that down, go to Africa, return to America, and do stand up for free in the parks of Seattle. That just shows how much the craft means more to his than money.
You know, he'll go down in history as the greatest for me because of things like that. It does matter. It shows what he's about. Do you know what I mean? He just wants to do comedy. Like you saying, the Kevin Hart and Joe Rogan stuff. You know, you've got Kevin Hart and Chris Rock, two of the greatest comedians of all time. They both go up, they do the bit, and they're happy. Oh, yeah, really good, really good. Chappelle turns up, does 40 minutes, and halfway through the set, they both look at each other, and like you say, rip up the material. And then they're both like, why the fuck are we even bothering anymore?
Yeah.
Do you know what I mean? Because that's the benchmark, and we're never going to get near it. And, you know, Kevin Hart's the most successful comedian on the planet in terms of money. You know, it's funny when Chappelle talks about taking his son to see him. Do you know what I mean? Like, you know, he jokes about how successful Kevin Hart is, and how his son was, like, you know, dead giddy to see him. It was embarrassing. But it's like, you know, but it's just that's the thing with Chappelle. It is just about the art. You're right. It's not about how much money I can make. It's not about how many arenas I can sell out. Dave Chappelle, you know, would be happy performing. You know, there's if you go on YouTube, there's bits of him doing in a basement in London, in, like, I think it's JoJo's comedy thing or whatever. Do you know what I mean? There's like 100 people there or whatever, and he's obviously not doing it for the fucking money. He's just doing it to come to England, and he wants to perform. Do you know what I mean? It's like, the guy is an absolute master, and he is. And it doesn't matter whether you go back to the early Chappelle when he's just, do you know what I mean, he's a kid, and he's like Eddie Murphy. You know, he was 17, I think, when he started performing. Or you go through to now, and when he's talking about, you know, like you're saying about George Floyd, he talks about, is it Slim? What's the
Slim iceberg, Slim the book. Yeah,
he talks about that, and he just addresses things. But he's consistently funny with it, and he gets you thinking. He gets you reaching for the books and going on Wikipedia and finding out a few things. He gets you thinking about where we are in life and stuff. And it's just like, you know what? You need that. You need voices like that. And I think Chappelle's just an asset, man. He's just an asset to us. He really is one of those voices we need and we've got. And I can't say enough good things about him. And you know what? People will say, well, certain things he shouldn't say or certain things, but he always pulls it back to, you know, if he's taking the piss out of, say, transgender, he's not taking the piss out of them. He's taking the piss out of himself and his attitude towards that and the fears that he has and how he needs to understand it better. That's what he's taking the piss out of. And you know what? You don't get to be edgy without upsetting a few people. It doesn't work like that. You can't be an edgy, safe comedian. And he's edgy and he's like, you know what? Cancel culture. Fuck you. Bring it on. What are you gonna cancel him from? His television show that he quit himself. His movie career that he only does films when he feels like it. Like, you know, pops up in A Star Is Born because Bradley Cooper's his mate. Do you know what I mean? You can't cancel the guy that isn't willing to be cancelled.
It's like that quote in it. There's nothing more dangerous than a man who has nothing to lose, and that sort of sums Dave Chappelle's comedy up, really, isn't it?
Yeah. If you cancelled him, you can't stop him from going performing in the park, and he'll do that, and he'll be happy doing that. Do you know what I mean? You can't. It's not like Kevin Hart says it. Kevin Hart has I've got the CEO hat on. I've got people that I'm responsible for. I've got a company.
Sponsors and stuff like that. Yeah.
Chappelle doesn't give a shit about any of that. He doesn't care. He'll go and perform. Do you know what I mean? And you can come for him, but you ain't gonna fucking get him. And I fucking love that man. I just do, and I just think, you know, I can't say enough. To be honest with you, mate, we both picked him. It's not just my pick there. You love him as much as I do. And it's just one of them, you know, anyone out there is watching this or listening to this who hasn't seen Chappelle or heard his comedy, just fucking get on it, man. Seriously. If there's one comedian you need to see, it's him.
Dave Chappelle transcends comedy and an art form all into himself. I've been Scotty. That's been Motty. Thank you for listening to the top five comedians. Let us know what your top five are. Comment, share, subscribe. Thanks as ever for doing as you have so far. We shall see you very soon for another podcast where we have heard that Kanye West is running for president.
Do you know what? In 2020, that's not
comedy.
That just sums it up, doesn't it? Probably make page 12 of the paper that. Can you, in other news, the president was arrested for murder. It's one of those, okay, fine.